Thank you very much, ma'am. Actually, we are going to move forward. We're not going to have an open forum yet because the talk, the next talk would be very similar. So we would like to introduce to you the next speaker. She has also given us the welcome remarks, of course, but I'd like to tell you more about her. Besides being the director of the biotech program, she has been the dean of the College of Agriculture in 2001 to 2007, the first woman dean of the College of Agriculture. She is also an expert in entomology with specialization in host plant resistance, plant breeding, and biochemistry. She also taught some courses in basic entom and crop protection courses and served as lecturer in graduate and undergraduate courses in plant breeding. She has received awards for her achievements in the field of entomology and was given the 1989 Outstanding Young Scientist Award by DOST, among others. One of the important ones was the Pest Management Award by the Pest Management Council of the Philippines in 2001. She has served as the technology advisor of a member of the National Seed Industry Council Board in 2002-2009 and the DA Secretary's Technical Advisory Group and STAG. Aside from all this, she's also involved in the Gawad Kalinga Development Foundation and served as project coordinator of GK Bayan Anihan Food Sufficiency Program. Again, let's welcome Dr. Adalia for her talk on helping solve the problem of the Filipinos.
Thank you, Ma'am Ola. That was really a very generous introduction. My topic is about biotechnology, particularly technologies generated by Filipinos for agriculture and projects funded by the Department of Agriculture. Next. All right. Next slide, please. All right. This is a very telling slide that was borrowed from Ma'am Ola's presentation. The current reality is that our world is apparently being modified, and there is so much problem, particularly population problem. Aside from that, the cultivable land area is decreasing, and malnutrition and poverty is increasing. And looking at the figure, it seems that the world that we have now would be two worlds in 2025 or 2050. No? We will have more mouths to feed, less land to produce our food, and more problems in malnutrition and poverty. And help me here. Taga Maynila naman ako ngayon ah. Bakit hindi ako sundin nito? All right. This slide shows us the statistics at home, particularly in the Philippines, which shows that we're not really into solving our hunger problem. No? By 2010 to 2012, our degree of hunger in various households, in Philippine households, is at its high time, ultimate high time, high of 21%, no? And it is really moving forward pa. Okay. Agriculture is playing a very important role in Philippine economy, or I think this global economy. And you will note that here, roughly 70% of the population lives in the rural area. And agriculture is playing about 33% of its share in total employment. And in the Philippines, excuse me, Anne. Alin yung forward. Okay. All right. Despite its minimum contribution in GDP, only at 11%, we know that it contributes so much in terms of, because it provides food, it provides raw material for industries, it provides employment to many Filipinos, and it provides support to other sectors. All right. And therefore, the challenge is to develop an agricultural system that is more productive, to have more food, that is sustainable and less ecologically disruptive. Okay. And we're saying that biotechnology can help. As early as 1997, our technocrats recognized the importance of biotechnology and incorporated this in the AFMA 1997 law, which recognize the potential contribution of biotechnology in transforming the Philippine agriculture from resource-based to technology-based sector. Biotechnology is looked at as the safe and responsible use of biotechnology is looked at as one of the options to attain food security, equitable access to health services, sustainable and safe environment and industry development. And here are the potentials. I think Dr. Mendoza had already shown this earlier, but let me just run this down. Fighting disease, the production of insulin was mentioned earlier, increasing yield, and environment friendly technologies like the development of materials that are plastic materials that has the biodegradable plastics, that makes biodegradable plastics. And of course, this is the one that is most most familiar to us, the development of GM crops like corn, cotton, and potato. And very recently, we have this development of nutritious food. And in the Philippines, we have the development of provitamin A rice. And then, of course, in terms of better industry, it was mentioned that biotech, particularly bioprocessing, can also be a very important technology. The tools were already mentioned. We have tissue culture, use of marker technology, and of course, genetic engineering. And I think the application of genetic engineering can be easily seen here. You deal on a very specific gene, so from a donor parent, when you put it on a recipient parent, you only put the specific portion of that chromosome or that gene in this recipient parent. So you don't transfer the other characters that are not desirable. Hala. Okay, so tissue culture. Okay, Jeanette. Oh, by the way, for those students who are around for appreciating the importance of genetic engineering as a modern biotechnology tools, we are saying that this is applied when the trait is not present in the germplasm of the crop. And I'd like to emphasize here the BT gene for corn borer resistance. You know, for so long a time I was involved in corn borer resistance development using the traditional plant breeding. Medyo tumanda na po ako, hindi kami nakakuha ng higher level of resistance, high enough, para ma-incorporate yung resistance na nakuha natin ngayon sa BT gene na ginagamit natin against corn borer. So, with the advent of modern biotech tools, na ilagay po yung BT gene dun sa genetic material ng corn borer, kaya meron tayong mataas na level ngayon ng corn borer resistance. Also, we use biotech tool to develop trait that's very difficult to incorporate using conventional breeding method. Kasi meron na tayong mga improved gadgets and equipments. And then, of course, in cases where it takes very long time to introduce or improve substrate in crop by conventional method. Ayaw niya ako sundin.
Ayaw niya eh. Ang kulit eh. Okay.
Alright. What are the gains that you have made? You're familiar with BT corn. This is the first and so far only GM commercialized crop in the country, planted to about 600,000 hectares, or had been planted in 55% of the total corn area in the Philippines. Again, let me emphasize that this is the only commercial crop that is a GM crop that is planted in the Philippines. Wala pa pong BT talong, wala pang BT papaya, wala pa po maliban sa BT corn. So, ito yung itsura. This is the BT and this is the non-BT component or counterpart. If you will look at this two pictures, you will note that the non-BT had some other damage aside from damage of corn borer. Meron siyang opportunity for microorganism to survive in it kasi may mga sira na yung grains. And therefore, we stand to have fungal infection or fungus that may be related or associated with aflatoxin production. Alright. In addition to the BT corn, we also have now the GM stock trait, which aside from having resistance to the corn borer, is now having resistance to herbicide. What does this mean? Pag tinanim natin yung mais, tumubo na siya, nagkaroon ng mga weeds, pwede natin siyang isprayan, mamamatay yung weeds, pero hindi mamamatay yung mais. And at the same time, may corn borer resistance din siya, plus other genes that goes with it. This particular variety is gaining so much popularity because this has been used in areas where they can practice zero tillage. Ibig sabihin, hindi na aaruruhin yung lupa, mapapagtaniman na nila ng mais. Okay. Bakit natin sinasabi na malaki yung comparative advantage ng BT corn over its non-BT counterpart? Well, we're saying that the BT protein from Bacillus thuringiensis that was inserted into the plant, the corn plant, provide it with the capability of this moth and butterfly larvae to be intoxicated, no? Nalalason sila. And then the BT gene that was introduced into this crop produced the BT protein. Actually, protein siya. Kaya ayaw natin siyang tawaging lason. Protein naman talaga siya na ang effect doon sa insekto ay pagkalason. Ngayon, kung hindi naman kayo insekto, eh hindi natin ine-expect na malalason kayo. Offers one season long protection against the insect and thus reducing insecticide use. Ito yung laging sinasabi natin, lalo na sa ating mga critics, na it's really actually a choice. It's a choice between corn sprayed with insecticide against corn borer and BT corn, which will get a very minimal insecticide application. On top of that, this new kind of GM corn provides corn borer resistance, which is complemented with herbicide tolerance. All right, what's the contribution of the GM corn in the Philippine corn productivity? Well, you will note that in terms of GM adoption, this graph or curve, it has significantly contributed to the overall productivity by this very drastic increase in the hectareage. No, as has been said earlier, in 2011, there are about at least 600,000 hectares grown to GM corn. And in terms of area harvested, I think it's this one, no? There is also an increase towards this here, no? And in terms of volume of production, well, you will see that it has tremendously increased by between 2010 and 2011. Oops. Okay. What are some of the crops in the pipeline? Pinoy biotech crops in the pipeline. Sabi natin kanina, isa pa lang yung commercialized, GM corn pa lang. Pero maraming product in the pipeline. And Dr. May had already shown you the delayed ripening papaya, which has some virus ring spot virus resistance in it. The very controversial BT eggplant. We have the BT cotton and the 3-in-1 golden rice. This slide shows us the virus resistance in papaya ring spot, and you can see that, I mean, very easily you can see the difference. This is the biotech papaya with virus ring spot resistance, and this is the susceptible counterpart. All right, on the delayed ripening papaya, this will allow the transgenic papaya to have at least 20 days more, no? So pag nag-ship tayo ng papaya sa ating sino ba yung ating number one taga-bili ng papaya? Maybe Japan, target natin ay Japan, pero mukhang ang Japan naman ay ayaw ng transgenic. Assuming na lang na ita-transport natin siya from any province in the Philippines, at least pagdating ng papaya sa atin ay firm pa siya at maganda pa yung condition rather than on the same day, 12 days, yung non-transgenic, eh medyo marami ng parts na nabubulok. Okay. BT eggplant, well, you're very familiar with this. This is landed in the newspapers lately. With BT eggplant, you can see that the fruit is clean, whereas the non-BT counterpart is infested with very voracious worm, the fruit and shoot borer. By the way, the recipient parent is also the same. We just incorporated the resistance gene in this recipient parent, and we got this very resistant progeny. Okay, why go for BT eggplant? Ang sabi nila, ang dami naman daw na po-produce na eggplant. Pero pag pumunta kayo sa palengke, bumili kayo ng BT, ay ng non-BT eggplant, parang ang linis-linis niya. Parang ang ganda-ganda ng fruit. Pero pag biniyak nyo, pinutol nyo, kikita nyo na may uod sa loob, no? Infested. With the BT eggplant, we decided to put modify the variety. This is Mara variety. Because this is the most inexpensive and popular crop grown and consumed in the Philippines as far as the vegetable is concerned, it is estimated that about 5.9 billion pesos of eggplant is produced and more than 20,000 hectares or 28% of the total volume of production of top vegetable in the country. And this is the more significant reason, because of farmers' dependence to chemical control, which oftentimes are no longer effective. And again, another crop in the pipeline developed by local Filipino scientists, the BT cotton. The non-BT is very much susceptible to the cotton boll worm. And studies have indicated that you need at least 10 to 12 sprays within the season to be able to produce not even a quality of boll cotton as good as this one. Now, with the incorporation of the BT gene, it was shown that you will need only about one or at most two application of insecticide throughout the season. Okay, more recently, genetic or GM has been used for breeding for nutrition. And because of this, there are thoughts of putting vitamins and minerals into the crops that we are normally eating. Our GM or the 3-in-1 vitamin A rice is the first crop that has been given or that has incorporated a better capacity to produce provitamin A. Okay, so this is how they produce it. They had two genes. Put this in the ordinary rice, and then you have this modified variety. Okay. May I also emphasize that aside from having this nutritionally enriched variety, we also have in that same variety some level of resistance to tongue grow and bacterial blight. That's why in some cases they call it the 3-in-1 golden rice. You don't only have the golden, the provitamin A gene in there. You also have gene for resistance to other major diseases of rice. I'm sorry for this. Okay, one more. All right. Now, another development in biotechnology, using biotechnology, is to use it in bioprocessing, as earlier mentioned or explained by Dr. Mendoza. And the Biotech program had funded projects that would look into the production and bioprocessing of natural ingredients, particularly crops that produce essential oils. So you have luyang dilaw, lemongrass, ilang-ilang, etc. The intention of these essential oils will be for pharmaceuticals, cosmetics, perfumery, and essences. We also had funded a project to extract rice bran to replace an imported counterpart used by the spa industry. And recently, we are looking into the natural components of seaweed as organic source of micronutrients for organic farming. Okay. Okay. We are also looking into biotechnology, particularly the bioprocessing of agricultural waste for high-value industrial products. No, Dr. Mendoza mentioned about better processing for safer and more nutritious food. I'll delve more on the enzymatic processing of agri-waste. Why biotechnology to utilize agri-waste? Well, we know for a fact that we have a lot of agricultural waste, no? As a source of natural colors for food, cosmetics, and other industrial use, this is not waste, but a crop called annatto or achuete to some of us is a very good source of natural color intended for food and cosmetics. For the waste of Saba, we have funded a project that will convert the peel into dietary fiber with the use of enzymes. No, and also source of of essential oils for organic crop protection product and micronutrients for biofertilizer fortification. And then raw materials for pharmaceuticals, nutraceutical, and cosmeceutical industries. There is a growing industry that would need natural products. And some of these natural products would come from agricultural waste. Okay. Okay, let me just assure you that the products that we test, the product that we release for commercialization, are really very safe because we have a very robust regulatory process in the Philippines, and these are some of the administrative orders and executive orders that actually governs the testing and commercialization of biotech products. This is EO 430, creation of the National Committee on Biosafety, and DAAO 8. In fact, the guidelines for field release and commercialization, also direct use as food, feed, and for processing, and then EO 514, which modified the national biosafety framework. Okay. There was a question this morning as to how do we do risk assessment? How sure are we that the technology, the biotech crops are risk-free? And I think it was emphasized early this morning that there is no such thing as risk-free technology. No, there will always be trade-offs, but let us assure you that this is the fundamental principles of risk assessment that we follow. Risk of biotech crops are no different from products of traditional breeding, meaning whether it is biotech or whether it is traditional product of traditional breeding, there will be risk. No? And the risk assessment should be on a case-to-case basis. Our regulation is said to be very strict because even if one product is approved and having almost similar event, no, the next product or the next event is still evaluated. And like, for example, the BT eggplant, no, the gene for BT eggplant is basically also the gene that was used for BT corn, but still we're subjecting BT eggplant to risk assessment and to the regulatory process, because we would like to see on a case-to-case basis whether the expected risk will be addressed. And then, of course, the risk should be assessed on comparative basis with appropriate control within the context of the proposed use, and that the risk should be addressed using scientific approach. We emphasize that we have to present evidence, no? So assessment is evidence-based. All right. Now, we are not the only group of scientists telling or saying that this biotech crops are safe, no? There has been a lot of scientific organizations that declared the safety of biotech crops, no? So we have this group or battery of organizations globally, and 25 Nobel Prize recipients, more than 3,400 prominent scientists have expressed support for plant biotechnology as a powerful and safe way to improve agriculture and the environment. So the proclamation of the safety of these biotech crops are not only done by Filipinos. These are done by scientists globally and by organizations around the globe. Okay, as I had said earlier in the opening remarks, we said that there is no conflict with organic agriculture and GM farming because they can coexist, no? And if you take a look at the figure here, you will note that the biotech, the country that grows biotech crops are also growing organic crops, no? So here we have the three most the best three countries, Argentina, Australia, and Brazil, all four U.S. And they grow both organic and biotech crops. And in the Philippines, this table shows us the benefits that we have reaped for growing the only biotech crop commercially available. Since 2003, since its introduction in 2003, it was computed or stated to have $170 million contributed into our economy. No? And if you try to compare this, in Brazil, their first biotech crop was also adopted in 2003, but look at the gains that they have made, no? 4.6 billion compared to ours, 170 million. And also in India, 1 year ahead of us in adopting biotech crop, had reaped 9.4 billion, no? And others. So I think let us also benefit from the biotechnology, from the promises of biotechnology. We look at biotechnology as a complementary technology for Filipinos to attain food sufficiency and increase rural income. And if I may assure you, these were developed by Filipino scientists, and therefore they also have the same nationalism that many of these anti-biotech crops people are telling us. So thank you very much, and good day to everyone. Just an acknowledgement, many of the slides and information were sourced from various papers presented in the regional biotech pre-biotech events. Thank you.